At the 1939 World's Fair in New York, the exciting new tech was the live television broadcast. Roosevelt became the first president to address the nation live on TV. But for years leading up to this event, engineers had been working on one particular technical problem: how to ensure the audio and video remain perfectly synced during the live broadcast. Without this, words and lip movements wouldn't match up, which would be annoying and distracting for viewers. So, how did they do it? Well, actually, they didn't. Instead, they discovered something pretty incredible. We are not very good at discerning whether audio and video are in sync. For example, I intentionally delayed the audio of this entire monologue nearly a tenth of a second. And did you notice? I'll clap to make it more obvious. The engineers also found that there's an asymmetry in our tolerance for this misalignment. We don't really notice if the sound lags video by up to 125 milliseconds, but we can tell something is wrong if it's leading the video by more than 45 milliseconds. And to understand why, take a look at this. Here I am bouncing a basketball as I walk away from the camera. The sight and the sound of the bounces match up perfectly. But as I walk away, you know the sound will be increasingly delayed due to the extra time it takes the sound to reach the camera. But the sound still appears synced. This is because your brain is not reporting to you each instant exactly as it happens, but rather a short interval of time reorganized to make sense. So in this case, your brain automatically aligns the sound with the sight of the bounce, at least up to a point. Once I'm over 30 meters away, the sound is now delayed by over 100 milliseconds and your brain no longer integrates the information from your eyes and ears. Here, let me play the actual sound of the bounce together with the sound as received by the camera. This explains why sound can lag video by more than it can lead. I mean, imagine you were at a basketball game, and because of how far away you're sitting, the sound is delayed. Your brain can handle that, but if the sound precedes the sight of an event, that would look really odd, because that's something that would never happen in nature. This is why the broadcast guidelines for acceptable audio and video mismatches are skewed in favor of audio lagging behind the video. Our brains are good at aligning audio with the vision that preceded it. We can actually exploit our auto-syncing capabilities to produce some strange results. For example, we created this computer program where when you press the spacebar, a light appears on the screen. But not immediately. There is an 80 millisecond delay between the button push and the light coming on. In a study, participants who familiarized themselves with a similar program came to believe that the light turned on immediately after they pushed the button, just as our brains synchronized the sight and sound of the basketball bounce.
Press the space key once to begin. This is just the section where you get the idea of what it does, so you push the space bar.
Now watch what happens when you remove the delay.
That last one came up without me even pressing anything.
You didn't press anything and it just flashed up there.
Right.
Some participants were convinced that the light came on before they pushed the button. They believed that something else caused the light to come on, even though it was their action that made it happen. This is remarkable because causality, the idea that one thing leads to another, is fundamental to our understanding of the world. Otherwise, how would we know who shot first? Babies as young as 8 months can demonstrate an understanding of causality. When watching a caregiver wind a music box, if the music stops, the babies touch the caregiver's hand to get the music to start again. Causality is something we're hardwired to recognize, but even this core part of our brains can be fooled. And the flash lag effect gives further insight into how this happens. Stare at the red square in the middle of the screen, and remember what you see when the flash happens. Where was the ring when the flash occurred? If you're like most people, you probably saw the flash in the top half of the ring. But what actually happened was the flash appeared in the exact center of the ring. So our perception of the flash seems to be delayed. To explain this result, scientists hypothesized that the brain was anticipating motion. You see the flash behind the ring because your brain is predicting where the ring will be, not where it actually is when the flash happens. To test this hypothesis, neuroscientist David Eagleman and his team modified the experiment so that the ring reverses direction right at the moment of the flash. Now, what did you see? If the brain was predicting the motion of the ring, you should have seen exactly the same thing as before, with a flash on the top side of the ring. But most people see it in the bottom half of the ring. How is this possible, considering all the frames leading up to the flash were exactly the same in both cases? If our brains were anticipating motion, then we would have had to somehow known in advance that the ring was going to reverse direction. And that seems impossible. So the alternative hypothesis is that where we see the flash occur depends on what happens after the flash. There is a delay between the flash occurring and you perceiving it, and the stuff that happens during that delay is actually incorporated into your perception of the event. This is incredibly counterintuitive, and it calls into question our perceptions of causality. The underlying cause of all of these illusions is the same. What we perceive as the present is not just one moment, but a short interval of time, which is around a tenth of a second long. Now, during this period, your brain can perform manipulations that distort your perception of time and rearrange causality. This interval has been called the specious present, a term coined by E. Robert Kelly all the way back in 1882. He said, "All the notes of a bar of a song seem to the listener to be contained in the present. All the changes of place of a meteor seem to the beholder to be contained in the present. The present is really a part of the past, a recent past, delusively given as being a time that intervenes between the past and the future. Let it be named the specious present." Why do we experience time in this illusory way? We feel like we're living in each instant, but what we're actually experiencing is a short period of time. I think it's not so that our brains can sync up the sight and sound of distant events, or so we can watch TV and movies without distractions, but because, fundamentally, our brains need to hold multiple moments at once to make sense of the world. Just as you can't read a book letter by letter, you can't make sense of the world and form memories instant by instant. So we live in the specious present, under the illusion that we experience each moment exactly as it happens. Hey, a lot of the research in this episode was performed by neuroscientist David Eagleman, and he's actually written a book entitled The Brain, The Story of You, which includes a lot of the details of his research. So if you want to know more about these topics, I highly recommend you check out his book. And in fact, you can download it for free by going to audible.com/veritasium, where this book is read by David Eagleman himself. But if you're not interested in this one, you can also pick any other book of your choosing for a 1 month free trial. Audible is a great audiobook website with hundreds of thousands of titles in all areas of literature, including fiction, nonfiction, and periodicals. Plus, Audible is a longtime supporter of Veritasium, so I really want to thank them for helping me to keep doing what I'm doing and making these videos. And I want to thank you for watching.